So I think that most of you have read the summary of my talk, and in the meantime, I decided to slightly change it and include some other considerations given the current actuality. So in fact, I think most of you heard about the decision by the Decadal Survey, the recommendation of the Decadal Survey, and among these recommendations, one of the key recommendations is the in-situ exploration of Uranus, sending an orbiter and a probe to Uranus. Given these recommendations, the first part of my talk will give you more detail about what can be done with the in-situ exploration of giant planets, and in particular icy giants like Uranus and Neptune. And the second part of my talk is, of course, related to the initial topic. Both topics are strongly connected, but on one hand, you will see in which ways the spacecraft measurements are useful to construct the models, and in the second part you will see how we use these models to derive constraints on the formation conditions of the giants of the solar system. So my outline is divided in two different parts. The first part is entry probes for the in-situ exploration of the giant planets, with a specific focus on Uranus. And the second part of my talk is the link which can be derived from the current composition of the giant planets and the thermodynamic conditions of the disk from which they form. So let's go to the first part of my talk, which is the entry probes for the in-situ exploration of the giant planets. The rationale for this talk is the following. So we all got the news from the US side, in which the Decadal Survey has deposited its recommendations. And among these recommendations, the top one recommendation is a Uranus orbiter and probe, which should be sent in between 31 and 32 from Earth, and it will take 12 years to travel to Uranus. And this spacecraft will be constituted in two different parts. One part will be the orbiter, and the other part will be a probe. So if NASA follows this recommendation, it is what will happen in the coming decade. There will be a mission toward this ice giant, and it's very exciting for the planetary science community. So what we guess, what we think about what will happen, we think there could be a partnership between NASA and ESA. So far, we know that ESA has allocated some money to contribute to such a mission. And for the budget which is allocated by ESA, it's a few hundred million euros. The most feasible scenario is a probe. So the ideal case could be an ESA probe contribution, which would be in piggyback with the orbiter made by NASA. So it's something which it's pure speculation, but I think it will be discussed in the coming months, because in 10 years it's very, very close in matter of time. And if we want to make something a partnership, it's now, it's not in 2 years, because the time scale is very short. And this kind of mission could be a kind of Cassini-Huygens mission, in which ESA built the Huygens probe, which was sent by the Cassini-NASA spacecraft in the atmosphere of Titan. So it could be a kind of similar combo, which would be sent to the Uranus system. The top two priority of NASA is also to define a flagship mission toward Enceladus. And if there is not enough money for a flagship mission, at least a New Frontier mission, which would be similar to the scenario we submitted to ESA a few months ago. So let's go back to the probes and why in situ measurements are very important for the people who are working on the origins. In fact, probes with this kind of in situ measurement, we can measure very precisely the elemental and isotopic composition of the atmospheres. That's very important. Thanks to that, we can get some constraints on on how giant planets form. So for example, today, there are still some unknowns about the origin of Jupiter, how it formed. Did it migrate within the protoplanetary disk? Did it form in situ? There are more and more studies which suggest that Jupiter moved inward and after went back to its current orbit. For example, there is a ground tack model proposed by Walsh, Morbidelli, and colleagues. But there is also a very recent paper published last week in Nature by Liu and colleagues, in which they propose also this kind of trajectory. It's not resonance dynamical resonance between planets. Here it is interaction between the planets and the disk, but it gives the same kind of constraints. There can be some inward migration of Jupiter during its formation, and after it goes back to a larger heliocentric distance. That's very important because if this kind of scenario did happen, it means that the current composition of Jupiter should have some leftover of this migration. We should be able to get some interesting measurement. And it is, if you do that for all giants of the solar system, you can derive extremely interesting constraints. So if we can get the elemental and isotopic composition of some specific atoms or molecules in the atmosphere of giants, that's an important asset. So for example, I present you some scenarios. Some of you know that. So there are several scenarios which describe the formation of giant planets. There are two extreme scenarios. There is a core accretion model in which the giant planet initially formed as a core. There is a core which results from the accretion of solids, ice, and rocks. And the mass of the core can be maybe up to 10 or 15 Earth mass, it depends on the planet. And after once the mass of the core is critical, there is a collapse of the gas onto the core. And what we observed from Earth and with some spacecraft measurements, we observe that the metallicity, the composition of the giant planet's atmosphere is not exactly protosolar like the Sun. It's enriched in heavy elements. So there are some enrichments which have been observed for carbon, nitrogen, sulfur, and also noble gas in Jupiter. And these enrichments, we have to explain these enrichments. And to do so, there are many scenarios which propose the accretion of planetesimals or solids during the growth of the planet. And these planetesimals could give these supersolar metallicity in the envelope of the giant, because when they fall into the growing planet, these planetesimals devolatilize and they lose their volatiles. So depending on the formation scenarios of the planetesimals, these planetesimals can be made of amorphous ice, they can be made from pure condensates, they can be made from clathrates, which is another crystalline structure. You have different patterns in the enrichment of the giants. So measuring these patterns in the atmospheres could give you some hints about which kind of material was accreted by the giant itself. And if you have some hints about the type of material from which the giant accreted, you can get some hints also about the place where this material formed. That's very important. So elemental composition is very important, but also the isotopic composition, because there are more and more isotopic compositions measured in the solar system. And one key measurement was performed, for example, in comet Churyumov-Gerasimenko by the Rosetta mission. The Rosina mass spectrometer, which was aboard the Rosetta mission, did measure the isotopes of xenon, and it allowed the authors to show that there are several xenon reservoirs from which the comet was formed, and these reservoirs are different from those which eventually form the Earth, which contributed to the Earth's xenon budget. So that's very important. So it seems that there could be several reservoirs. So comparing, for example, the isotopic composition of noble gas in giants with those measured in other planets or comets is essential if we want to disentangle between the different existing formation scenarios and how these noble gas were supplied to this planet. So measuring the noble gas in the giants is a very, very important measurement. Not only their abundance, but also their isotopic composition. The advantage of in situ measurement is very important because, for example, it's impossible to measure the noble gas, their composition, their abundance, from remote sensing measurement. It's impossible to measure argon, krypton, and xenon from remote sensing. The only way to do that is to perform a mass spectrometry measurement. And there are two possibilities. Either you take the material and you analyze it in the laboratory. In the case of a giant planet, it's more complicated. So you have to bring the laboratory towards the giant planet. It is done by the spacecraft. So Cassini-Huygens, for example, and the Rosetta mission had the very powerful mass spectrometers aboard. And the advantage, if you send a probe in the atmosphere of the giant, you can reach several bars of depth, and these layers are out of reach from remote sensing measurement, not only for noble gas, but also for other species. The question is, can we reach the homogeneous interior of the giant with a probe? It's almost impossible, because a probe can go up to 10, 20, maybe 30 bars, but the very deep layers, it's maybe 1,000 bars. So we cannot reach anyway the well-mixed layer. But regardless of this difficulty, we have access to a wide range of measurements which are essential for planetary models of planetary formation. So for example, one excellent case is a Galileo probe measurement. The Galileo probe was sent in the atmosphere of Jupiter in 1995 by the Galileo orbiter. And thanks to the Galileo probe, we got for the first time the noble gas abundance measurement in the atmosphere of Jupiter. It is what you see here in the left diagram. You see the enrichment in argon, krypton, xenon. So you see they are all between 2 and 4, 5 times the protosolar value. You have also the measurement in carbon, which is supersolar, nitrogen too, sulfur and phosphorus. And there is one problem. You see that oxygen is depleted. It was the measurement by the Galileo probe. Oxygen is depleted, but we quickly realized that this measurement was not representative of the bulk abundance of oxygen in Jupiter, because the Galileo probe was sent in a dry region of Jupiter. Imagine that you want to measure the oxygen abundance in the atmosphere of the Earth. And imagine you are yourself aliens and you send a probe towards the Earth. If you send a probe above the Sahara Desert, it's clear that the most measurement, the humidity measurement, will not be representative to what you see above the sea. You have the measurement you have above the sea level on Earth. That's the same kind of problem we faced with the Galileo probe. The region in which the measurement was completed was not adequate for this kind of measurement. And the measurement went down to 22 bars before the end of the mission, 22 bars in the atmosphere of Jupiter, which is already very good. And what the researchers got, they saw that because there was sampling, there was measurement at different depths, and the data showed that the oxygen abundance were growing with time. So it was growing with the depth, and the signal was stopped at 22 bars. And so what we learned with Juno, the primary purpose of the Juno mission was to measure this oxygen also. And the researchers working on Juno, they discovered interesting things. For example, they saw that the atmosphere of Jupiter is very, very, is not very well mixed. Juno went down to at least 100 bars to try to probe the oxygen. And even at this depth, it's not sure that the oxygen measurement is representative. And it was the same for the nitrogen measurement. And so there are still difficulties to measure oxygen in Jupiter. The constraint is not very well established. I will show you later the error bar, so we will see that it's still important. But Juno confirms that Jupiter is not very well mixed, at least until 100 bar. We need to go much deeper if you want to reach the homogeneous layer. That's the problem. So I would say it's a weakness for probes, but not exactly, because what I say, it's valid for commensable, but it's for in the case of all isotopes and noble gas, it's not valid, because all these species, their abundance, their isotopic ratio, do not depend on the phase which is considered. That's very important. Double gas are all in vapor phase in the giant, so they are well mixed. And isotopes, if you measure, for example, the carbon isotopes, if either carbon is in solid form or in gas phase, it does not change the situation. So probes are also important to identify the key processes which are at work in the atmosphere of giants. So clearly, this kind of in-situ measurement allows to study the chemical, dynamical, and aerosol forming processes which are at work from the thermosphere to the troposphere below the cloud decks. So that's the primary aims of a probe are twofold. On one hand, you can strongly constrain the formation models and evolution models, but also you bring a lot of constraints also on the atmospheric models. For example, just by having a precise measurement of the pressure and temperature vertical profile, it's a key measurement. For example, the Galileo measurement of the PT pressure temperature profile was very useful for the people who worked on the data of Juno. So that was very important. So if you decide to send a probe into a giant, and in particular Uranus, so the required measurements are the following. You need to define the temperature profile, temperature pressure profile down to at least 10 bars. You will have to measure the abundance of noble gas and their isotopes. You will have to measure the abundance of carbon, nitrogen, sulfur, and phosphorus. You will have to measure the isotopic ratios in nitrogen, oxygen, and carbon. You will have also to measure the cloud and haze properties, measure the ortho to para hydrogen ratio, to try to determine the vertical wind profile, and also measure the conductivity of the atmosphere. That's very important. All these points were addressed by the Galileo probe in Jupiter. So at least we have to do the same thing in a nice giant. So typically, all these measurements can be performed with this kind of instruments. So the key instrument in such a mission is the mass spectrometer, which allows you to measure the composition with precision. You need also an atmospheric structure instrument, which will help you to measure the vertical profile of temperature and pressure. A tunable laser system can perform additional measurements compared to the mass spectrometer of the isotopic composition. It's a very well detected instrument, but it's independent from the mass spectrometer, so that might be good to have some redundancy. And measuring the abundance of helium is so important in the giant, so you will have to have another instrument apart from the mass spectrometer to measure this abundance. For example, a jamming interferometer. There is also radio science, which allows you to measure winds, speeds, and the direction of the winds and the chemical composition. A nephelometer, which allows you to derive the particles, the shape, the structure, and the size of particles, the haze, and the speed of some instrument, for example, to measure the ortho para hydrogen ratio, and an efflux radiometer to get the energy balance into the atmosphere. So such a spacecraft, so we have numbers about the weight of such a spacecraft. We defined a few years ago a Saturn probe, which was the proposal was submitted to ESA. At that time, we derived a weight of about 200 kilos for a Saturn probe to get this requirement, 200 kilos. And I would say that the structure of Uranus is fairly similar to that of Saturn in terms of entry characteristics. So an Uranus probe will have the same physical properties as a Saturn probe. So these two kinds of probes will be very similar. The numbers given here for the Saturn probe will be valid for an Uranus probe. So we have also a heritage at ESA, and also NASA, of course. The US sent the Galileo probe in the atmosphere of Jupiter. There are many proposals regularly submitted to NASA, to the different calls of NASA, for example, to New Frontier, to send a probe into Saturn. For example, the New Frontier 4 Saturn probe mission, which was led by Amy Simon. She's trying to submit another probe to the next call, New Frontier. On the ESA side, of course, we worked on the Huygens probe. The Huygens probe was built by ESA and sent to the atmosphere of Titan. There were several proposals in the past sent to ESA to propose to several entry probes. There was a Kronos proposal, which was also a Saturn probe mission. There was an internal study at ESA, the ESA PEP study performed a dozen of years ago. And there was also the Hera Saturn probe mission, which was submitted twice to ESA in 2014 and 2016. So I think that ESA is in very good place if a partnership will be established with ESA as the main supplier of the probe sent to Uranus. And of course, what I said earlier is the following. The Decadal Survey strongly recommends to go to Uranus. Should NASA follow this recommendation, it would be a great mission to which ESA could contribute in a significant manner. So keep tuned, keep informed, because it will happen very soon. I think in the coming months, we'll have the definitive answer about what kind of partnership we have between these two agencies and to the benefit of the whole community. And to finish, the probe community is smaller than, of course, the JPL community, but it is a very active community. There is, for example, a meeting which will take place in Maryland at APL between July 12 and 14. This meeting is still open, so I encourage all those who are interested in in-situ measurement in GIANTS to come to this meeting. And we already did many different meetings in the past. There are several special issues which have been published. So it is a very active community. To finish this first part of my talk, I will show you this figure. This figure is interesting because I hope I convince you that sending a probe, which was cost is about 400 to 500 millions of euros, is very useful. But when you see the fate of a probe in the atmosphere, you have to be very convincing with the taxpayer, because look at that. This figure represents the trajectory of the probe, the Galileo probe, within the atmosphere of Jupiter. So the end of mission was after about 2 hours, 1 hour and a half. And after a few minutes, the first part of the probe started to melt. Aluminium melt at about 2 hours. After that, it evaporated because the probe was going deeper. And after 9 hours of mission, the most refractory part of the probe evaporated. So after a few hours, it's just in vapor phase. So that means that these data are very expensive. That's the message. They are very expensive, but very useful, because more than 25 years after the Galileo probe mission, we still use this data in our models. So that was very useful. Okay, so now I'm going to shift to the second part of my talk, which is, of course, strongly related to what we discussed in the first part. I want to establish the link between the composition of the disk and the composition of the giant planet. And what are the processes which allows you to start from the composition of the disk to the current atmospheric composition? And you understand that working on that, it's related to probe measurement. So I show you again this slide, which shows you the enrichment in Jupiter, derived from the Galileo measurement. So just for the sake of information, look at that. You have Jupiter. You have several points of measurement for these species, for argon, krypton, xenon, and so on. Look at Saturn. Saturn, you have just 3 data points, despite of the fact we had a wonderful mission, which was the Cassini-Huygens mission. But you see that despite of its capabilities, Cassini was not able to go through the atmosphere of Saturn. And there were not Saturn probe aboard, which were in piggyback of the Saturn, of the Cassini spacecraft. That's the reason for which we don't have many data regarding the composition of the Saturn's atmosphere. That's a pity. And that's the reason for which we have to send also a probe to Saturn. But it will be less difficult than sending a probe to Uranus and Neptune. And when you see the composition of their atmosphere, look at that. Look, the error bars are the carbon measurement. These error bars are huge, and those are the only data which we have precisely. So clearly, Uranus and Neptune, we almost don't know from what they are made. And that's very strange, because the exoplanet community, they see hot Neptunes every time. They measure planets whose mass and radii are very similar to those of Uranus and Neptune. And the 2/3 of the populations of exoplanets detected are this kind of planet. So you see, that's very important to understand Uranus and Neptune. It will not only understand, it will not only help us to understand the fate and the evolution of the solar system, but it will also help us to understand how these other planets formed. So for Jupiter, this plot, which is very similar to the previous one, shows you the oxygen measurement by the Juno spacecraft. So you see the oxygen, and you see the R bar of oxygen, which is a bit above that the Galileo probe oxygen measurement. That could be a nice constraint, but not that much, because it is a 1 sigma error bar. But if you consider a 2 sigma error bar, the error bar could be lower than the one derived from Galileo. In other words, that's very complicated what we get. It's still possible that the oxygen in Jupiter could be depleted. The Juno measurement was not precise enough, and it seems that, unfortunately, it will be difficult to have in the coming times a better measurement than this one, which has been published in the recent literature. So how can we explain Jupiter's of supersolar metallicity? I go back to this slide. Apart from oxygen, which remains an unknown, you see that the other species, argon, krypton, xenon, carbon, nitrogen, sulfur, and phosphorus, they are all enriched, they are all supersolar. So how can we explain this supersolar metallicity? As we discussed earlier, there are two main formation scenarios of Jupiter. There is a core accretion model. So you have a core which forms from the accretion of platysmals, and after you have the hydrodynamical collapse of the envelope. The other model is the disk instability model, in which there is a cloud. It's like a star, the giant planet formed from the collapse of a dense gaseous region of the disk. And there is settling of material in the center of this cloud, so you form the core, and after there is the envelope. Both scenarios can explain the supersolar metallicity of Jupiter, because in the case of the core accretion scenario, you can have the accretion of solids during the collapse of the envelope, and it is also possible to accrete a supersolar gas directly into the core. So that means if you can attract supersolar gas during the formation of the giant planet, this scenario is compatible with both the core accretion model, but also the disk instability model. So both models are compatible with the observations. And there are other scenarios which have been invoked in the literature for the disk instability. Planetesimals can be captured during the pre-collapse phase of the evolution of Jupiter. And also you can have differentiated clumps which are accreted by Jupiter during its formation. So there are several scenarios. I would just want to mean that, unfortunately, this supersolar metallicity does not give important insight regarding the formation mechanism, even if today we prefer the core accretion model for a dynamical reason. So now we are going to explore two possibilities: the delivery of volatiles to giant planets in solid forms. It is exactly what we see here. So several scenarios have been proposed in the literature. The solids could be made from amorphous ice. So this ice will originate from ASM, and Jupiter, for example, will have formed in a very cold region of the disk, maybe a much more further region from the region in which Jupiter is today. And to be the only reason from which we could explain the formation of amorphous ice and its accretion into the forming Jupiter. But for dynamical reasons, this scenario does not work a lot. The other possibility is that Jupiter accreted some pure condensate, crystalline ice, which condensed in the protosolar nebula. There are two kinds of crystalline ice. One kind could be pure condensate, solid ice, for example, pure ice of N2 or of CO2 and so on. The other option is to accrete Jupiter from clathrate. So clathrate, these crystalline structure in which you have entrapping of molecules. So clathrate are very famous in the field of geology on Earth, because there are many clathrate on Earth, CO2 clathrate, CH4 clathrate. But you should be aware that clathrate have been proposed to be part of comets. For example, there are some observations which suggest that some comets could have formed from clathrate. Clathrate, their existence has been proposed also on Titan. It could explain some features which are observed from remotely. There are many solar system objects which could have a lot of clathrate in their interiors or their near surface. And so there are some cases where Jupiter could have accreted this kind of solid during its growth, and it will explain its supersolar metallicity. So for example, here what you see is a condensation sequence of different ices in the Protostar Nebula. From this kind of condensation sequence, the horizontal curves, what you see here, it is the equilibrium curves for some ices. So blue ice correspond to pure condensate, and the red curves correspond to clathrate. And that, I will not go into detail, but this, each of these cases correspond to a given scenario of Protostar Nebula composition. And so what you get here during the cooling of the disk, the Protostar Nebula is cooling, so it proceeds from high to low temperature, and you will condensate different ices as a function of time, and you form the building blocks from the mixture of this ice which condense within the Protostar Nebula. And these building blocks will be later accreted by Jupiter and the other planets also. So what you get here is the pie chart representing the composition of the ice accreted by the forming Jupiter, for example, in each of these different scenarios. So you have scenarios in which you have just pure condensates or clathrates and so on. And so, for example, this kind of models allows you to reproduce the enrichment observed in Jupiter. So the blue bar corresponds to that data, yellow data or Juno data, and the red bar corresponds to feeds from models. So the main conclusion from that is that these models are able to reproduce the elemental composition of Jupiter. So accretion of Jupiter from pure condensates or clathrate works. It works well. We can match the observed enrichment. So this is the first mechanism, accretion of solids during the growth of Jupiter. And what I say here, it's valid for Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune. It's more convenient to show that in the case of Jupiter because there are more constraints thanks to Galileo. There is, however, so these solids, what you see here, when they accrete by Jupiter, they must be big. It must be kilometer sized. Because if these solids are smaller, there is an issue. Let me show you what happens here. So there is this movie. I don't know. Yes, it works. So a movie from a simulation from Frédéric Masset. So when Jupiter grows within the Protostar Nebula, it accretes gas and material. And at a given mass, it forms a gap. There is void. There is an annulus of void around Jupiter. And from this point, it is impossible to accrete solid if they are small. Well, by small, I mean pebbles form, millimeter to centimeter, 10 centimeter size. It's impossible to accrete these small solids. So there is a problem. So either Jupiter accreted big planetesimals, but in this case, there are some issues regarding their accretion by Jupiter. Or there is another alternative. It is the accretion of Jupiter from supersolar gas. And you don't need, in this case, any solids. So it is the scenarios we explored also in the past year and very recently. For example, here on the top left scheme, I show you a view of the Protostar Nebula. And we assume that the solids accreted by Jupiter, the forming Jupiter, are amorphous. So amorphous ice is expected to be formed in the ISM. So amorphous ice is accreted within the protoplanetary nebula. And these amorphous ice, these grains, are drifting with time. And they start to release their vapors, their adsorbed volatiles, at a temperature of about 143 K. So at this time, when they release their volatiles, these volatiles are released to the gas phase of the disk. That's a very important consequence because if you found Jupiter at this level, at the right temperature in the Protostar Nebula, the gas from the Protostar Nebula will be fed by the volatiles which are released by the amorphous ice. That's very important. So it's a paper we published a few years ago, but there is also another scenario which is a kind of derivative. So there is a case of amorphous ice. The other case is, let's assume that The dust and ices which were in the protoplanetary disk were made from pure condensate. So those temperatures of sublimation vary between 20 and 150 K for water, for example, but CO and N2, you see, it's about 20 K. So can we explain Jupiter? And it is what exactly what we did recently, it's a paper which is in press. I will show you later the results. So here you see that we can explain the metallicity of Jupiter if you assume that the disk was filled by volatiles released from amorphous ice. If you form Jupiter at 7-8 AU, something like that, it's fairly easy to explain its metallicity by accreting gas released from amorphous ice. That's very important. And of course, the oxygen abundance will vary as a function of the distance to the sun of the giant, of the formation region of Jupiter. The other case is the one I mentioned you, the accretion of Jupiter from pure condensate. And it's exactly what we did recently with Artem Agishin, who is ending his PhD with me in Marseille. And it's a result from his simulation of the protostellar nebula evolution. And so he computed the multiple ice line within the disk, and he was able to release volatiles, many volatiles to the disk in gas phase. And yes, you can still form Jupiter from vapor only. Not only he found that, but he also found some case in which Jupiter could be formed from vapors and solids. So that all the options remain open. It is the result which is in press, but you can find the paper on S4PH. So it's 22, it's not 21. So the conclusion of these different results, what I will say. So in summary, the metallicity of Jupiter's envelope is consistent with both the core accretion and disk instability models. The core accretion model is preferred to the disk instability model for many other reasons which are related to the dynamical of the disk, for example, the surface density of solids, which is important beyond the snow line, and the disk instability model itself, I think it's not a requirement. But it is interesting to see that it's what we calculate, what we get with the metallicity of Jupiter is consistent with the two models. If you assume that Jupiter metallicity was the result of the evolution of pebbles throughout the nebula, these pebbles have to be formed from amorphous ice and pure condensate. And also the oxygen abundance in Jupiter, which is poorly constrained, it is clearly related to its formation location within the protostellar nebula. And depending on this formation location, we can derive where Jupiter formed. Unfortunately, we don't have precise measurement at Jupiter to be precise in prediction for the formation location of Jupiter. If Jupiter formed from planetesimals, bigger planetesimals than pebbles, which quickly decouple from gas. So in this case, these planetesimals were not sensitive to the formation of a gap around Jupiter. So we find that a wide range of planetesimal composition can explain the enrichment. These planetesimals can be made from pure condensate, clathrates, and I would say that the mass of volatiles, which need to be ejected in solid form in Jupiter's envelope, is consistent with those derived from Juno in the interior of Jupiter. So we are fully consistent. I think it is the end of my talk, 40 minutes. Thank you very much. I'm open to questions.
Thank you.